All right, welcome back, and this is going to be part three, the final chapter of the Pioneer Component Car Stereo we've been working on over the last few weeks. And when we left off last time, we had just discovered that based on what we found in this tape deck, that more than likely, we probably had a slew of bad capacitors in the tuner as well. But I did get some good news on that. I'll show you what I found. There's two circuit boards in it, an upper and a lower. The lower circuit board, luckily for me, they used 95% all Nippon caps, and so they were all good. There wasn't a one of them that was bad, but there was quite a few on the top board, which is the board I could easily get to and get out of the unit that needed to be changed. And I did get those taken care of. Also received the belt for the mechanism, so of course this video will be 100% focused on the mechanism of the tape deck. But before we do any of that, we'll come in and we'll take a quick look at the work that I did on the tuner, and then we'll get immediately started on the mechanism. And of course, keeping in line with all the other videos, going back to Fire of Unknown Origin, picking up with one of the songs that was used in the heavy metal animated film, Veteran of the Psychic Wars. Let's check a little bit of this out, and then we'll pick back up on the Pioneer. I can't say if we're ever gonna be free. Don't let these shakes go on. It's time we had a break from it. It's time we had to leave. We've been living in the flames. We've been eating out our brains. Oh, please don't let these shakes go on. All right, let's go ahead and come back in real quick, and we'll take a really brief look at the tuner and the work that I did while we were waiting for the belt to arrive for the mechanism. The tuner has two circuit boards in it, the top one IF-RF, the bottom one systems control, and the rest. That bottom board, 95% all black Nippon caps. There was a few, two or three Panasonics. They were a different value than the ones that had been kind of giving me trouble throughout this entire system. And so I only had to focus on this top board, which is fairly easy to get out. I think there's one screw here. You remove a ground wire attached to the switch frame, and then there's a ground wire on the back here you'll have to remove, and then of course pull your grommets up from the wires or from the one from the antenna. So we'll take a look at the caps I did change, basically the ones that have been giving me trouble throughout the entire thing. We have a 220 at 10 here, 100 mic at 10, and that's a 47 at 16. There was one of the small light blue Sanyos here, which is 0.68 at 2.5. That I replaced with a 1 mic at 50. And then we had four or three 10 mic at 16, I believe is what those are. And then we had another 47 mic at 10 or 47 at 16 right there. So replaced all of those, got everything up and going. And I'm going to go ahead and get the top of this put back on. And we're going to move right on to the mechanism. I'm going to go ahead and get this removed out of the deck again, get it flipped upside down, get the camera set up overhead, and we're going to go ahead and get started on this. So give me a moment for that, and we'll pick right back up. All right, so as we come back in, I went ahead and got the mechanism back out of the unit so we can do the service on it. And just kind of looking over things, the idea is to get this back plate off, covering the capstans up where the belt is located. Appears the only real obstacle to that, if we can zoom in here, is they've done some pretty creative wire routing around this piece over to the side and then around by the capstan motor with some really tight tolerances to where the wires don't come into contact with the capstan itself, the capstan motor itself. So I want to kind of undisturb this as little as possible, or disturb it as little as possible, to avoid having to have those wires kind of fall out of their natural position they've been in for so many years. And just taking a look at this, we'll look at the capstan motor itself first. Very nice unit. Got four wires going into this thing, a positive, a negative, and two white wires. And I would imagine that those are probably for speed control. There is a service manual for this tape deck on Hi-Fi Engine, but just for it, maybe, I don't know if it's for this model or maybe another model that's very similar to this. I can't remember, but I did download it just so I could find out where the speed control is so we can set the speed. But got a date code of 81 on the motor, and it would be tragic if there was something wrong with that, because I don't see any substitute going there. Such a very tight spot, such a small, kind of tall, slim motor that goes in there. I had a hell of a time getting the pressure rollers cleaned up in this, but I did that before I even put one of my own tapes in it, just to make sure that they weren't nasty. And they cleaned up pretty good. They still got some good pliableness to them. But the head and everything looks real good in this. These hubs look good on these motors. They spin really good and real free. And just kind of peeking around this mechanism a little bit, all the sliding pieces, everything seems to move very freely with no grease issues. So we're certainly not going to start tearing into all of that just for the sake of doing it for preventative maintenance reasons. Kind of following the rule on something like this, kind of following the rule of better is the enemy of good. I mean, we've got it good, so may not be the best idea just to start tearing it down for no reason when everything's moving and sliding pretty good. So let's go ahead and start by taking out these three screws. And I realize my hand will be blocking some of these shots. Let's see if I can zoom out just a tad bit here. Well, it'd help if we get the right screwdriver. And my goal here is to pull both capstans out, make sure they have some oil on them, put those back in, and then from that point, yeah, you can see here, maybe this is glued down. Let's see if we can get that freed up just a little bit. Again, trying to be as minimally invasive as possible. So they glued this to the top of these two solenoids right here. And so that gets kind of the whole piece moving. But we still got a few wires we need to deal with. So we'll start in the back here. I see two orange wires. We'll see if we can lift those out of here. Got those freed up. Now it might possibly. I said might possibly. But I've got some wires right here too. So let's see if what we can do about maybe trying to remove this piece. Looks like it's just some kind of a terminal board. There's a couple of resistors there. So just some type of intersection for some wires to meet. Or maybe there is a particular part of the circuitry. It looks like these wires are going down probably into these motors right here. So this is probably where the voltage comes in for those real motors. And again, I'm just trying to, just as cautiously as I can, lift these wires out of here without creating too much of a disturbance. So when we put them back, they'll kind of fall right back into the position that they were in before. So that brings us to here. There it is. There's the belt. You can see it's got a couple of indentions in it. Now, I used the service manual part number of this belt and cross-referenced it with a PRB number. And they came up with 10.1, and so we'll see if that turns out to be the case. Most of the time, more than not, it's right. And I would say that's okay, because we don't want a lot of additional slop here. We want this to be a good fit, not too tight, but not to have a lot of slop in it. So, and we can see again the indentions there where that belt's been sitting for years. So I don't think there was any clips holding these down. So we're gonna pull them out, making sure we know which one's which. Maybe they are completely compatible. You could put one in the other side, but we're gonna do it the way that they had it. And we're gonna clean those up and put some oil on them. And while we're in here, there is something that is of interest to me, and there's a switch here, which I figured there would be. There's two, actually. So it's probably not a bad idea for us to clean the contacts up of those switches. And also, just to kind of get an idea of how things are moving here. This is the part I really couldn't get to, and it all seems to be doing pretty good. Might not be a bad idea just to put just the smallest amount of oil there, just to ensure that it all starts to move together, moves, slides real easily together. But before we do that, let's take this switch out and see if we can see how bad it is to get to it and clean up the contacts of it. I assume one of these switches is for the cassette detect in switch, and the other maybe for music search. All I need to do is just get this switch up just enough to where I can get to the contacts of it and get it cleaned up. It looks like it's always in the on position. So it's like always shorted. So what I'm gonna do is I got a really, really thin piece of sandpaper here, or burnishing paper if you wanna use that term. So I'm gonna trim that down just a little bit. We're gonna use it to clean up those contacts. I also do this, I have a small file that I do this with too, but I just happen to have this handy today. And again, I realize that my hand is blocking this shot a little bit. So the next thing we want to do is avoid shooting control cleaner all over everything. So I'm going to get a towel to put around this. Give me 1 second for that. And maybe this switch was fine. And obviously it was working, but we want to make sure it continues to work without a problem. And at the same time, make sure we don't flood this capstan motor with control cleaner. Because no matter how careful you try to be, that control cleaner does come out of the can pretty quick, even with the slightest touch. And then I'm going to use this again just to work on these contacts. And then we'll do it one last time. If I don't lose it first here. And of course, I wouldn't expect the camera to be able to capture this, but these contacts look really, really good. They've cleaned up real nice. So I'm going to do this one more time with just a little bit of control cleaner. Kind of dry it off a little bit, and then we're going to put it back. And we'll put our screw back in. And I'd have to consult the service manual. I'm not sure exactly what that does. Probably something to do with the music search. Maybe it has something to do with auto eject. I'm not sure what it does. All I do know is that while we're down in this far, cleaning that switch up is definitely not a bad idea. As the same with this one over here. So let's take a peek at it. Keeping in mind that it goes underneath this little arm coming out of here. And this switch, we can get a good look at it, and we can see the contacts of this are pretty bad. So this one needs some attention for sure. And again, this is the time to do it while this thing is taken apart. So I doubled over a piece this time, and let's see here. This being a bigger switch, a little easier to access and get cleaned up. Now we'll go ahead and do the same thing here, only this time having a much easier time of it, because we can just lop it over here. And this can is just about spent. And then one last time. And you can see the difference here. Let's see. I can get you in here. See how nice and clean looking those contact points are. And so I'm sure this will go a long way in making sure that every time you stick a tape in it, it won't kick it back out or refuse to operate. All right, so I'm gonna pause here. Got someone texting me I wanna take care of, and then we'll pick back up. I'm gonna go ahead and put this back in, and then we'll work on the capstans and change the belt out. So give me a moment for that and we'll pick back up. All right, picking back up with you. I did go ahead and get that switch put back in. And now we're going to move on to cleaning up these capstans and cleaning up the capstan motor spindle a little bit. And for that, we're just going to use a little bit of acetone. Obviously, it wouldn't be a good choice if these parts were plastic. But we're just going to kind of get off any kind of residue that might be on there. And then we're also going to clean the actual capstan themselves. You can see there's some stuff coming off for sure. All build up from the old belt that had been on there for decades. Let's see here, seems like we're kind of getting out of focus a little bit. Let's try that. Currently in the midst of a storm here, so hopefully we do not lose power. Starting to look pretty good there. And of course, we're going to put a little bit of oil on these before we drop them back in. And then we'll have to clean them before we can put a tape back in it. Looks pretty good. I did go ahead and just drizzle a little bit of control cleaner on all these little sliding pieces just to make sure that they maintain their fluid movement. And this one not quite as bad as the other one. And that should be okay there. Now let's see if we can get a swab onto the spindle of this capstan motor here and get it cleaned up a little bit. I don't see a lot of residue on it, so the swab's probably not going to pick much up. Lucky it didn't turn to goo, and we have that mess to contend with. There's a little bit there. Worth getting another swab and going over it one more time. So yeah, you can see there's a little bit there. Just not easy to see with the naked eye. May have taken just the first swab or two to kind of get it loosened up to where it would start to come off. And I will normally clean on this until it comes back, until a clean swab comes back still pretty clean. All of this contributes to the speed and making sure the speed is pretty accurate. So we'll do one more swab here. It's starting to look pretty good. I don't see anything else on it, but I didn't see it to begin with either. So we'll go one more round. See, that's coming back clean now, so I think we're going to be all right there. So let's go ahead and we'll put a little bit of oil for the capstans. We're just going to use some 3-in-1 machine oil. It's perfectly fine. I'm sure they make tons of oils that are supposed to be super awesome or whatever, but I've always found this to be perfectly fine. I'm just doing it down in this lower portion of it, because that's the point, that's the part that's really going to make the contact inside the little sleeve that it sits in. Then I'll usually raise it up and down a couple of times just to get it evenly distributed. And then we'll do the other one too. And when you're raising these up and down, there should be no resistance whatsoever. It should just come up and down very smoothly. And there we go. Now I'll wipe my hands off and we'll get set up for the belt to get put in. Brand new. Hopefully I remember the pattern. I think it goes something like this, perhaps. There we go. Looks good. Feels good, not too tight, not too loose, just about right in the pocket. All right, so what I'm gonna do now is I'm gonna go ahead and pause. There'll be no need to film putting this back. We're just gonna reverse the process. And once I've got it all back in, I'll bring you back and show you what the thing looks like completed before we stick it back in the rest of the unit. So give me a moment for that. All right, so as we come back in, I went ahead and got the bottom plate for the capstans put back and got all of our wiring routed fairly accordingly to what it should be. Didn't really disturb anything over here, so I didn't really have that to worry about. And this one in the back went back in very nicely. Cleaned up the capstans from where we oiled them, got that all taken care of. Now everything seems to be looking pretty good. So I'm gonna get ready to drop this back in the rest of the unit and we'll test it out and set the speed on it. A couple of things first. I did re-glue this trim piece back onto the front of the tuner when I did the work on the tuner. I went ahead and put the amplifier back together. And I also found two of those Panasonic caps in there, and I went ahead and changed both of them just to make sure we didn't have an issue. There was a slight bit of corrosion that caught my eye that I didn't see initially, and so that was the only two that was in there, so I went ahead and changed those as well. So let's drop the mechanism back in the cassette and let's try it out and set the speed on it. So give me a moment for that and we'll pick back up again. All right, so as I come back in with you, storm still raging on here, but went ahead and got the mechanism put back in the unit, went ahead and reinstalled all of our little cardboard dividers and the plastic one on the left side of the preamp section here. I was even able to get the factory tape kind of reset where it was. So kind of giving the appearance that the unit's never been worked on, which is always my goal when working on something, is to try to make it look like there hasn't been anybody in there. In this particular case, though, these caps would probably give that away to somebody that knows what caps and something this old would look like. I got a tape in it now, and I've just been kind of going through the fast forward, rewind, music search, functions of everything. So we'll go ahead and stop it here and see what we got. There's a stop function here. If you hold that down while it's in play, it will pause. When this is in fast forward and rewind, of course, all you have to do is momentarily hit that and it'll go back to play. So we'll pick back up and then we'll flip it over to the other side and listen to the other side of the tape. One push is regular rewind. Two pushes is music search. So we'll kick it into music search. I don't know, there's not a lot of silence between these songs, but it did catch that. All right, I think we've done our due diligence with this. Let's go ahead and get the speed alignment tape loaded into this thing. To set the speed on it, there is a hole right over here on the lower left side of the chassis. There's a potentiometer right inside that hole that is used to adjust the speed. Doesn't sound to me like it's off too much, but we will load up the speed tape and check it out. And for that, since we have it wired back to the amplifier, we'll just unplug one of the connections to the bench speakers. Actually, we'll unplug both so you don't get an earful of test tone. And we'll just direct the camera up to the frequency counter here. Let's see, there we go. That should be good. And let's see, I probably want something to adjust that with. All right, here we go. And we'll turn off all of the Dolby and the metal tape or chrome tape capability. And let's see, am I on the right side of this thing? Yeah, 2980 is where we're at. We're looking for 3000. So let's see if we can tweak it out. A little too much there. Now, according to the manual, there is a pretty wide deviation from one side to the other. So we have the forward side, 3003. So let's eject that. We'll flip the tape over and we'll see what it looks like on the other side. It shouldn't be too far off from that, I wouldn't think. Yeah, 3009 for the other side. I think that's going to be just fine. They again have a pretty wide latitude there for the speed difference between one side and the other. So it's a very well-governed capstan motor from what I can tell. And we did a good job with the mechanism, making sure everything is running nice and smooth. So I think we're going to be okay. I'm going to go ahead and get this thing back together. It's been here a very long time, and we're going to do a final play test on this and wrap this one up. So give me a moment for that, and we'll pick back up. All right, so as we pick up one final time, having a look at this incredible Pioneer component car stereo. As always, I want to thank you guys very much. Appreciate you checking out the video or the series of videos for this unit, as well as all the videos on the channel. Thanks to Patrick for getting in touch with me and sending this up to get it worked on. It was a very cool project, no question about that. And otherwise, just taking a look at the four pieces, I've kind of glanced at it several different times, wondering what the application. I don't think you're sticking this in the dash of any type of car, probably with a, even with custom mounting. You know, it would almost like you would need to put this maybe in a customized van from back in the day. You know, the ones that had that overhead compartment. The ones that had that overhead compartment and where you could kind of slot a space out for each one of these pieces and spread them out, where you could get the full effect of the visual awesomeness of this as well as the, you know, access to it, usefulness of it. So don't know, but I'm sure he'll figure out something to do with this nice old Pioneer system. So on our way out, of course, we're going to finish this series of videos with Blue Oyster Cult's masterpiece song from Fire of Unknown Origin, Burning for You. And just because this is such a special stereo, I used one of two. I have these sealed in the package, a TDK SA90 chrome tape. This is the one I took out of the package and recorded one song on it. And of course, it is Burning for You. So we're going to check this out. And always, as always, again, I want to thank you guys very much. Appreciate you checking out my videos. So let's check out a little bit of this.